Hachette Audio presents The Perfect Assassin, a dark savage thriller. Written by James Patterson and Brian Sitz. Read by Joshua Kane and Suzanne Elise Freeman.
One. Eastern Russia, 30 years ago. A mother can sense a disturbance in her world, even in her sleep. Marisha did. The late-night snowfall made the small village on the Kamchatka Peninsula look like a cozy Christmas painting. But the wind was harsh. It whistled around the cottage and seeped through the walls of the tiny nursery where the 6-month-old twins slept in a single crib, spooned together for warmth, like tiny dolls. They were just 5 minutes apart in age, with matching features and the same delicate, pale skin. But the similarities stopped at the top of their heads. One girl had her father's dark, straight hair. The other had lush, copper-colored curls, like nobody else in the family. Marisha was a physicist. Her husband, Mikhail, was a mathematician. In their courting days at the university, they had long talks about what extraordinary children they would have together. And that's exactly what happened. 2 in 1 day. The babies were remarkable, so beautiful and loving. And now, at just 1/2 year old, already advanced for their age, they were everything a parent could wish for, and more. Mikhail had put the girls down just after 7. At 2 a.m., Marisha woke suddenly. Something was off. She could feel it. She pushed back the covers and slipped out of bed, not bothering to nudge her husband or find her slippers. She grabbed her robe from the wall hook and wrapped it hastily over her nightgown as she hurried down the short hallway, feeling the cold tile against her bare feet. When she opened the door to the nursery, a waft of frosty air crossed her face. In the next second, she felt a matching chill in her gut. She took a step toward the center of the dark room and inhaled sharply. Snow dusted the floor under the half-open window. Marisha grabbed the side rail of the crib with both hands, then dropped to her knees and screamed for her husband. Mikhail stumbled into the doorway seconds later, his eyes bleary and half-closed. He saw his wife on the floor, and then the empty crib. His eyes opened wide.
They're gone,
Marisha wailed.
Both of them gone.
2. A mile away, 2 thick-set men in heavy wool coats were making their way up a rugged slope. The village lights were already fading behind the scrim of wind-blown snow. The footing was treacherous, and they were not familiar with the terrain. Bortsov, the taller of the pair, used a heavy hiking pole to probe the path ahead. Gusev, the shorter partner, carried a high-powered hunting rifle. In their opposite arms, each man carried a tightly wrapped bundle. The men were killers by trade, and this was their first kidnapping. In fact, it was the first time either of them had held an infant. They clutched the 16-pound babies like rugby balls. After 20 minutes of steady hiking, they were out of sight of the village. Still, Gusev kept looking over his shoulder.
"Stop worrying," said Bortsov gruffly, pointing at the trail behind them. "We were never here."
He was right. Just 1 few yards back, the snow was already filling their tracks. The search would begin at dawn. By then, it would be no use. Bortsov had scouted the campsite the day before. It was a natural shelter beneath a rock overhang. He'd even taken the time to gather wood for a fire. By the time the kidnappers reached the spot, it was nearly 4 a.m. They were both exhausted from the climb, and their arms were cramped from gripping the babies. Bortsov walked to a snowdrift about 10 yards from the shelter.
He bent forward and set the bundle he'd been carrying down in the snow. Gusev did the same with his. They stepped back. The twins were about 4 feet apart, separated by a snow-covered log. They were both squirming under their tight wraps, their cries muffled by wool scarves around their heads. Bortsov pulled a handful of coins from his pocket and placed them on a rock in front of the baby on the left. Gusev placed a bunch of coins in front of the baby on the right. Then they shuffled back toward the shelter and started a fire. When the wood caught, flames and sparks illuminated the small recess. The kidnappers tucked themselves under the rock and pulled their thick coats up around their necks. Gusev fished a flask of vodka out of his coat pocket, took a deep gulp and passed it to his partner. A little extra warmth. Before long, their eyes were glazed. Soon after that, their stupor faded into sleep. The babies, left in the open, were no longer crying. 3. Morning. Gusev woke first, stirred by an acrid waft of smoke from the smoldering fire. He brushed the snow off his coat and shook his flask. It was empty. Gusev's head throbbed, and the inside of his mouth felt thick and pasty. He glanced across the small clearing to where the two babies lay silent in the snow. He elbowed Bortsov in the ribs. Bortsov stirred and rolled over. Gusev nodded toward the twins. Both men rose slowly to their feet and walked on unsteady legs to the snowdrift. Over the past few hours, the wind had blown a fresh coating of white over both babies. Bortsov pulled the stiff scarves away from their faces. In the dawn light, their skin was bluish, their lips and nostrils coated with frost. Obviously dead. A total waste of a trip.
Weak. Both of them, said Gusev, spitting into the snow.
Bortsov turned away, snarling in frustration.
Food for the bears, he muttered.
As Gusev retrieved his rifle, he heard a small mewing sound. He turned. The baby on the left was stirring slightly. Gusev hurried back and knelt down. He pushed the frozen scarf back off the baby's head, revealing coils of copper hair.
We have one, Gusev shouted. She's alive.
Bortsov tromped over.
Mine,
he called out with a victorious sneer. He scooped both sets of coins from under the snow and pocketed them. Then he lifted the copper-haired girl from the snowbank and tucked her roughly under his coat. Gusev gave the dark-haired baby one final shake, but there was no response. He kicked fresh snow over the tiny corpse, then followed his partner up the mountain, cursing all the way. He hated to lose a bet. The walk down the other side of the mountain was even harder than last night's climb. Bortsov's knees ached with every step, and Gusev was coughing in the thin, cold air. But they knew the effort would be worth it. They had conducted the test with the babies side by side as they had been instructed. A survivor this strong meant a big payday, maybe even a bonus. An hour later, Bortsov and Gusev pushed through the last of the tree line into a rolling, snow-covered valley. Straight ahead was a campus of sturdy buildings made of thick stone. A few simple balconies protruded from the top floors, and most of the windows were striped with heavy metal grates. In the early morning, a light glowed from a corner room where they knew the headmaster would be waiting for the new student. Bortsov pulled the copper-haired baby out from under his coat as they approached the imposing school gate. He knew the headmaster would be pleased. This child showed exceptional promise. Part 1. Chapter 1. University of Chicago. Present day.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.